Okay. How many of you manage to stay in your heart with your partner for at least 2 seconds? Anyone manage 2 seconds?
I did not say.
Stay in your heart when your partner's talking. 2 seconds will be a good start. This is very hard to do. And you'll notice something else. When we get into our reactive patterns, we don't get out of them in 5 minutes. Sometimes we take quite a while. So the difficulty is our partner needs to hang in for quite some time while we go round and round and round like the washing machine that's still going, churning around. So it can take some time to stay in that heart space. And frankly, it takes a lot of practice to do that. Do you want to make a comment, Ian? Because we had a wee discussion about this. It's not easy to do. Do you want to add something from your own experience?
Oh, I can't really think of is there anything? Yeah.
That's all right.
Getting upset and, that's right. I was talking about with Lucy over the kitchen table, and I started to defend myself, and she said, "Well, you don't have to defend yourself. I'm not accusing you or attacking you about this. I'm just stating that this is what happens." And at that point, I said I had to leave. I said I was too wound up.
Very nice.
I couldn't think.
Yes.
My mind had gone.
Yes.
I had a thing. I said, "I'll get back to you on that." And I did, but it took a couple of days.
So what you did, which we've talked about before on the course, is about taking time out when you can see you need the time out. And that will still happen because we get triggered, right? We get triggered. So we know we need to take time out to calm down. And the truth is, that's very realistic. And what you did was really helpful. You said to her, "I need to take time out." So she knows you're taking time out for that purpose. It really helps if we do that. Yeah, so we can't always go into this heart space. Like, this is the... This is a practice. Being in your heart is what you get to just before you're about to ascend into the samadhi, you know, the higher zones. The truth is, it's not easy to do. So
there's a little bit of a, for me, my experience has been just trying to find out where the essence is of, like, where does this start? So there's some things that weren't healed for me with my parental relationships, which can't ever be actively healed in this life because my parents passed. So acknowledging that is sometimes emerges in the tussle that happens in my relationship that's alive and well today.
Yes.
And just acknowledging that own resolve stuff.
So,
it's the business of this relationship, but it becomes the business of this relationship.
Yes. Let me just go over what you just said. It's a really important thing. You've got quite a lot of self-awareness. So what you just said, what I've talked to one or two other people about, is when you get into a pattern, here's my pattern again. Like you're talking about a pattern, right? I know my pattern. I need time out to calm down from this pattern. So when we know our pattern, we can say, "Oh, I know this. Oh, I've been here before. I know I used to do this with my in childhood, or I used to do it with my previous partner or something." And what you're doing then is you're owning it. Now what you do when you own it like that is you say, "Oh, okay, here I go. So let me just calm down. Let me just take a moment to calm down because I can see my path." And it's really good if you say to your partner, "Hey, look, I can see my path." Like you said, presumably more or less, "I'm in my pattern. I need to take time out for my pattern. I'll get back to you." And in avoidance, we learned from previous sessions, it's important that the avoid proactively comes back. Yeah? No. So you don't just go away and stay away. Preferably you come back in time, which isn't too far in the future.
Actually, when an avoidant does go away, they are in their pattern, just even the act of going away. But it's actually about keeping communication. That's what makes the difference.
Yes.
So for me, I want to chase you.
Yes.
That would be my pattern. So
yes.
I have to really work with my pattern, not chase you.
Yes.
And you have to work with your pattern and communicate so that that will reassure the anxiety.
Nice summary. Challenging, isn't it? Surely won't be a relationship. How good.
We took the English.
Yeah. He has part of school, his wife, it's called Lucy as well, that's why you might get a bit. But we had a chat. Is that what you were saying?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
But Francis brought up a really important point. When you get to know the pattern of reactivity and you own it, like Ian did, and you say, oh, look, I need to take some time out because I've just been triggered or something, then what happens is much, much easier for your partner when you've owned it like that and said, I need to take time out. The crucial thing to know, though, is we all have patterns. You can't be a patternless person. We all have patterns, and so we've got to know when they're triggered. We've got to preferably, ideally, own it and say what we need to do. So you know you need to time out, and you know sometimes, hey, look, I need to work with the pattern, so you talk to your partner about that. The crucial thing is that we need to know it. The real difficult about the relationships is for most people, they're full of invisible stuff. It's just invisible. So you can see, if you're going to stay and be loving, you really have to know you've been triggered. And say, like Ian might say, okay, I can really feel I'm triggered. Then I need to take some time out. And then maybe he comes back when he's worked with his emotion, he's come down and said, okay, let me hear you. And let me try and stay in this loving space rather than take any umbrage about what you're saying. Because it takes practice to do this. But I wanted to do it on this last day because I wanted you to see that actually it's doable if you just practice at it. But I understand some of you are practicing just managing to identify your reactive pattern, let alone staying calm with it. Okay, this is a good discussion. Anything else? Thoughts? Okay. This is chapter 28. Remember the word weaknesses came from last week when we were talking about that young guy who was reactive, who chose not to react to the policeman when the policeman was unjustifiably giving him a hard time and being abusive to his to others in his life. So what he wanted to do is he wanted to use this policeman incident to actually help his weakness so that he could learn to be strong and not be reactive. Not many people are particularly 15 up for doing that, let alone much of later ages. These are the 10 mindsets of successful couples. That's what chapter 28 is about. The four first one, the four, I don't know if you remember reading this, the first four are actually built into a spiritual tradition, and it talks about that in the book. Number one is really important, because what happens when people get upset with each other, they lose the impeccability with their word. They start to say things that they regret, and they start to dump. And that's really important to learn not to do that. You really have to control what you're saying. The second thing is, and we've talked about this also, if you start taking where the other is at personally, you're going to react to their reaction. So it's really important to, so what you did, Ian, you can see you took it personally first up, right? And then you said, uh-oh, I don't want to take this personally. Lucy helped you understand that. And then you need to take time out so that you depersonalize it, work with yourself, and come back and be not taking it personally. It takes a bit of practice. Assumptions are what happens because people are different. So what people frequently do is they assume what the other's doing and where they're at. They make assumptions about the other person, what they're thinking, what they did, what they meant, all this sort of stuff. And that really comes from poor listening and not talking enough about your needs and preferences. That's why you have to talk and listen in order to make sure that you really understand where the others are at. Otherwise, those assumptions are going to get you to hold water. Always doing your best is really important. Even if you've lost it, even if you lost it, you still pick up from the point where you've lost it and try to do your best. Earning the need to upskill. All of you have upskilled. To get to this point, of course, you've all upskilled. But you're probably going to find that this is an unending job. And the reason it's an unending job is because we've all got a damaged past. And so we're upskilling for a damaged past, basically.
Or we've all got a house to keep clean. You just want a nicer environment to live in, so you've got to
attend
to your environment.
So what you're saying is it's life, just learning to look
after. I choose to look after our hearts.
Right, just like you with your house.
It's like watering the precious plant that London has got.
Exactly.
Sorry, what was that?
It's like watering the precious plant.
Yes.
Essentially in the cupboard.
Yes.
I choose to work on
the garden. That effectively is what John Lennon was saying. You need to upskill by watering the plant. Yes, it is very important to know that actually we all fight for individual freedom. We all want individual freedom. Here's the where it comes unstuck the most. Where it comes unstuck is when we feel the freedom is being limited or trimmed by our partner. And so what we then do is we fight for our freedom. And that's when we get control versus feeling controlled. So if we go into our relationship and say, okay, I want to back for your freedom as well as my freedom, let's talk about these freedoms we want. But in actual fact, that's not what happens in most relationships. Most relationships have a controller and a controlee, to varying degrees. So in actual fact, really supporting each other's individual freedom is not so easy to do. The seventh part is really interesting, because you've got to totally accept yourself warts and all. Because you've got warts, like no one's not got warts. The thing though is to say, oh, that's my wart, I need to work with that because it can get that out of control, right? I've got that particular wart, so I'm going to work with it. But don't expect it ever to completely be gone, because they're deeply embedded. But if you know warts and work with them, they'll become less intense and less reactive. Number eight, always consider the needs of the relationship. It's not just about you, it's not just about your partner. The relationship needs balance. So if you're talking about the vacuuming, who's going to do the vacuuming, you're talking about the cooking, talk about the childcare, talk about where the money's going to come from, you're always seeking balance. The relationship requires support, not just each person in it. In fact, there are things that the relationship needs that are separate from the individual. For example, a relationship needs constant communication. Constant sharing, constant affection, like John and Yoko showed. Constant affection. That is the need of relationship, not just the individuals, but the relationship needs that. Number nine, give up being right and instead meet needs. I think we've dealt with that before. It's pretty obvious. If you're still being right, then what you're doing is you're missing out on five and six. Number ten, discipline yourself to repeat what works. So you now, because we got this far in the course of an individual work with me, either or both, what's happening is you're well down the track of understanding a lot of your patterns. But you have to discipline yourself, because you still get into them. You'll still get into them, but hopefully less intensely, and you'll get more skills to process them. Any questions about this? No? Okay, I'm going to get you to do some exercise in a second. So, we've been through that. I've got this slide in twice or something. Okay. We've sort of been down something like this before, this track, but I've altered it a bit. So, let's look at our weaknesses. So, I'm going to get you to go with somebody else in the room, not your partner, because you're going to get back to partners in a second. Probably after we have a break. So I want you to talk with this other person, and it's probably good to choose someone with your own attachment style, ideally, probably easier. you'll get more benefit from it. Talk about the most triggering emotions you experience and how these destroy your feelings of love. What emotion, so if we took Ian's example, he's feeling, say, criticized, and so he has to get out of that criticism in order to come back to loving his partner and know, oh, this is my pattern, I can feel criticized. Okay, yes, come back, own it, come back. Discuss number two, ways in which you've successfully avoided conflict with your partner with being loving help. Now, how have you avoided, what have you done so far? And would being loving and staying in a loving space help that? Number three, discuss the listening strategy you've been most successful with so far. Could they include dropping defenses and focusing on being loving? Another partner, preferably your own attachment style, and five, maybe 10, 15 minutes, will then have a break. And after the break, we'll do this with partners. Off we go. Have a good time. I'll get John and Yoko to sing to you while they're doing it.
You're a big guy.
He did super well. He stayed very low.
It's a bugger when you get old and can't get up.
I know.
Maybe it's just doing the group that was split. Sometimes, so you don't want to.